Let's talk a little bit about encryption, and specifically kind of modern encryption and how it works. Right. Now, before we jump straight into something like the advanced encryption standard, I wanted to talk about SP networks, right? Or substitution-permutation networks, because they are the basis for a lot of modern cryptography. Not all of it, but a lot of symmetric cryptography anyway. Dave has done a lot of videos on things like Enigma. Enigma is your kind of classic cipher, and it's a substitution cipher. Just like the Caesar cipher, it's just that its substitution is a little bit better than the Caesar cipher. So with something like Enigma or the Caesar cipher, you've got an input, which is, you know, letter one, letter two, three, four, five. This is the message going this way. And this is going to undergo some kind of substitution and turn it into another one, which let's say is kind of ciphertext 1, ciphertext 2, ciphertext 3, ciphertext 4, and so on, each one. Now, there's a lot of problems with the Caesar cipher, right? And there's a few problems with Enigma. But one of the problems is that there's only ever a one-to-one mapping, right? That is to say, this character is encrypted and becomes this character, and this one is encrypted and becomes this character, which means that however complicated your substitution is, to work out the mapping, you really need to focus on these two characters alone. If this ciphertext was based on 10 of these characters, that would be a little bit more difficult already, right? So we could say that the Enigma machine or Caesar cipher has a block size of 1, right? Which is that it encrypts a block of one character into an output of one character, right? Now, modern encryption doesn't work this way. Modern encryption has a block size that's quite a lot larger, right? Certainly, this is for a block cipher, right? So a block cipher is something that takes a block of a certain size, let's say 128 bits, and it turns it into an output or ciphertext of 128 bits. Right? So what I wanted to talk about today was a very simple example of a network that you can make significantly more complicated and end up being the most used algorithm on the planet. Right? Not the one I'm going to show you. So this is an SP network. The idea is that what we want to do is combine some kind of substitution process, so changing characters for other characters, with something called a permutation process, swapping characters around, XORing things to other things, moving things about. And that way, not only is the mapping between the input and the output confusing, but it's moved all over the place, so it's even more confusing.
Right. Well, technically, that's what Enigma does though, right?
No.
Yeah, because every time you change it, the mapping changes.
Ah, no, yes, good question, right? So let's go back to this. So what Enigma does is it changes this substitution every tick, but it doesn't mean that this goes to this, and this goes to this, and this goes to this. So it's still one-to-one, it's just that the substitution is confusing and changes, right? So it's still got a block size of one, right? Enigma, I guess, would be better if it had a bigger block size, but I don't know how they would wire that up. What we want is some kind of slightly larger block. So I'm gonna have a four block substitution, right? So I'm gonna have something called an SBox, right? An SBox, I'm gonna draw it like this, takes four bits of input, so these are the bits, right? These are 0-1, 0-1, 0-1, 0-1, and it outputs four bits. And then in it, I'm gonna come up with some rules. So when a 5 goes in, let's say a 7 comes out. And when a 14 goes in, a 2 comes out, right? And I can come up with some rules, right? So I'm gonna make up some rules now. I'm not gonna draw them all in here because I've already run out of space. So this is 2 to the 4 possible combinations, so numbers between 0 and 15, right? All zeros to all ones. Okay, so let's come up with some rules, right? So, for example, let's draw the inputs. So, in what 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Fast forward through this bit. I think those are all the different combinations, right? I'm gonna use a different pen, because otherwise it's gonna get confusing. Okay, these are some rules that I've come up with. Now, these are not particularly good. There's a lot of reasons for this. One is my SBox is too small. Right. But the other thing is that I've paid a little bit of attention to things not going back on themselves. But so things like, if a 1 went to a 10 and a 10 went to a 1, that's kind of invertible, and that's kind of statistically weaker than if you didn't do that, right? So there's rules you should be careful about when you're designing these kind of things. I mean, my best advice would be to use the ones that have already been designed and not develop your own. Let's put a number through here. So let's put the number 12 in through this SBox. Okay, so 12 is 8 plus 4 plus 0 plus 0. So 12 goes in and 12 maps to 5, so that's going to be 0, 1, 0, 1, 4 plus 1. Okay, so this comes out as 5, right? Now, this could go into another SBox or to some other process, right? The idea is that you're just mapping numbers to another number. Now, this on its own is like a terrible version of Enigma, right? A number goes in and a really poorly masked number comes out, right? It's terrible because everyone can see this. As soon as you know what this is, you can just invert it. We need more than this. Okay. So what we do is we also implement some permutation. So let's come up with a permutation box. A permutation box in my example is just going to move things about. So we're going to take, let's say, an 8-bit permutation box. So that's going to be like this. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 bits of input, 8 bits of output. And then we're just going to mix it up. So we're going to take that one over here, and that one over here, and that one over here, and that one there, and that one there, and that one all the way over there. This is getting confusing. I'm running out of lines. That's all of them. Okay, right, I made that up. So, I mean, is that good? I don't know. But it's not important how good it is as a cipher. So you would have two SBoxes here, two 4-bit SBoxes, for example, plugging into one 8-bit permutation box. So the outputs of these get jumbled about and mixed up here. The way an SP network works is it repeats substitution and permutation over and over again. So I'll just draw like an example without drawing all the lines out again. And then we'll go through using our permutations. So you might, for example, have 4 bits in and another SBox here, 4 bits in. These 4 bits come into our permutation box and go through that mapping, which I won't draw out again, but that one, right. And then out come 8 bits of ciphertext in some sense. So let's put a number in and see how it works. Okay, I've got control now. Pick a number between 0 and 255 for my 8-bit cipher.
103.
Okay, I'm going to give you the camera back now before I break it. 103, right, let me get a pen, a different pen. So 103, 0110 0111, right? I checked because making a mistake would be too embarrassing. Now, so let's do this SBox on its own first, right? These are my rules I've got here. Okay, I'm going to refer to them just sort of on the side. This number here is 4 plus 2, which is 6. So if I look in here, 6 goes to 8, so that's 1000. So 1000, like that. 0111 is 4 plus 2 plus 1, right, which is 7. So I look 7 up, goes to 3. That's not very interesting, but all right. 0011. Okay, so I'm going to start trying to, I mean, because I haven't drawn them in here, I don't know where they're going. But this one goes all the way to the end. So this one comes down here. This one goes to that one, apparently. That's not very exciting. So that's a naught. This one goes to here. This one goes one across to here, I think. I didn't separate them out. Not very exciting. Okay. I mean, the output's mostly naught. That doesn't help.
I'll pick a better number next time.
Yeah, that's it. Do you not know anything about my cipher? I've got completely lost about which number I was churning on. Which
one? Put this one in there.
That one. So one goes to there. Yeah. Okay, so it goes one there, one there. Yep, we can cut this out and it will all look great. That one goes to there, that one goes to there. You would program this up so you weren't quite as slow as me, right? Because AES, for example, can encrypt at 700 megabits per second. I can't. I've done 8 bits. And it's taken us way too long. Okay, right. So this number is, so 16 plus a 4, that's 20, plus a 1 is 21, 21. So is this a good cipher? Well, let's put aside the fact that it's trivially decryptable and say, well, 103 is not a lot like 21, so intuitively, maybe, right? It's not absolutely terrible. Now, on its own, this is not very good. This is called a round, right? And the idea is that what you would do is you would repeat this over and over and over again. And hopefully, you wouldn't just be switching 8 bits about. You'd have a whole 128-bit block. And over time, bits from the very left are getting moved over to the very right and having effects on everything. Right, so this mapping becomes much, much more confusing. The other thing is that we've got to introduce a secret key, because without a secret key, if you know the code for this, you can just reverse the process. This is not hard to reverse. The inverse box is just the reverse lookup of this table, and this permutation is just the reverse direction for all these wires. So how do we introduce a key? Well, this is called something called key mixing. So what we have is we have our message, right, which is the size of our block, thankfully. We're going to put it through a round like this, round one, and we're going to put it through round two, and then we're going to get some ciphertext. Now that alone is not very good. So what we do is we have our key, our secret key, and we expand it into a nice block of this length, and we split it up to be, let's say, 3 chunks long, right, in this case. And the first chunk is XORed with this here, and the second chunk is XORed here, and the third chunk is XORed here, like this. And that means that once you take the key away, you can no longer reverse this process, right? The key is the secret bit. We all know how the SBoxes work, we all know how the permutation box works, but as soon as you take the key away, we're a bit stuffed, right? if you have the key, decryption is really easy. You expand the key, right, something called a key schedule, and you start with a ciphertext, you XOR it with this bit of a key, you go through the inverse of here, you XOR it with this bit, you go through the inverse of this, you XOR it with this bit, and you've got the message back. So you can go forward, you can go backwards. All you need to do is change these right arrows to left. If you take the key away, you can't perform these XOR operations, which are going to be flipping bits and completely muddling around with the input. So none of this is going to work, right? You'll be able to achieve absolutely nothing, right? What we don't do is keep our SBox or our permutation box secret, right? Because it would be easy to decompile the code and work out what happened. What we do is we develop really, really good SBoxes and permutation boxes, and then we introduce a key schedule to mix our key in. And then when you take the key away, you can't break it. Right. That's how a modern SP network works.
You've got two rounds there. Are they usually more and are they different?
There's usually more, they're not different, right? So typically you'd use the same round, it's just your round's really good. The number of rounds you use will depend on the algorithm, the strength of your round function. So AES uses between 10 and 14 rounds. The way it's designed is that you increase the number of rounds until you can't break it anymore, right? That's the idea. If you use too few rounds, there'll probably be some statistical mapping between the input and the output. You might be able to work out how to break that cipher. On the other hand, if you just use a billion rounds, then no one's going to be able to do anything because they're all busy encrypting and it's going to take too long. So there's a compromise between how many rounds you use for speed and how many rounds you use for security, right?
And is this used in anything we can put our finger on now, this SP?
Absolutely. So this SP network is the basis for the advanced encryption standard, and the advanced encryption standard encrypts almost every connection over the internet, right? The one you're using now. We'll talk another time about AES, the advanced encryption standard, but it functions quite a lot like this. It's just that they've given a little bit more consideration to their design than I have. What you'll find, I think, if you watch a video of a cycle GAN being applied to every frame of an image, it's going to be a little bit noisy, right? So you're going to have to take steps to try and smooth that out.
Yeah, 38 billion hashes per second, which is why MD5 is not usable in any sense anymore, ever. Don't use it. Okay, is that clear yet?